see free. Apparently there was, because they abandoned their old one and they come up with a new one. Tell us that they didn't have, that they did have the money. Well, apparently not, because they raised $500,000 since that time to get some things in place. Tell us that the building was good enough. Apparently it wasn't. They got plans to get a new building. I mean, we did what we were supposed to do. We just asked the commission to do what they're supposed to do and uphold our findings. And then have the applicants do what they're supposed to do. Resubmit to us and let us make a ruling on your new application in November.
So if the applicant can come in the commission, his address data does not meet us, and it comes down to that one piece of the dual language piece, and them not addressing that need, but in their application, they seem to think that there is a need for a school in East Birmingham, a K-8 school in East Birmingham that serves the population there. Do you think there's a need for a school like that in East Birmingham?
I think that, again, we have to sit down with the board members and we all determine what the need is. If the applicant comes before our office and it's a good application, you know, it would be different if we said, and certainly we have opportunity to say, that this application has met all the requirements with the exception of A. And then have the board make a decision based on that. But to override and to do it this way, I think it's inappropriate. I think that we have to follow the letter of the law. We have not had an opportunity to say, but they did everything in dual language. We simply said they missed 9 different areas. And again, it was not limited to those 9. I think that when they reached out and got some help, they realized it was not limited to those 9 as well, because they could raise some other things in the application that needed to be corrected. At some point, you know, I think we just got to follow the law and let's see how this works out. I don't know legislators, but I assume, and I believe in the process. I believe that they sat down and they presented the law that they believe in, and I think it behooves us to let it play out and not to second guess. Everybody second guessing Birmingham saying that they don't believe in charters and they're against charters. They were against charters and never would have became authorized. They never would have gone through this process. We're doing this because we believe in our kids. Let the process play out. Let's follow the letter of the law and we'll see what happens after that. But right now, no one has done anything to block charters. We just simply said this applicant wasn't ready at the time. Will they be ready tomorrow? The boss spot. Men, what have they done before?
Any other questions for Mr. Taylor? I would just offer one point, and it's not intended to imply anything, but in Alabama, it is a state form of education. And the State Board of Education, along with its appointed officer, the state superintendent, really had jurisdiction over all the public schools. And what it delegates or chooses to delegate to the locals is what they are authorized to do. You have a law that takes precedence too. But it's also appropriate that the state superintendent is authorized to interpret, as the law says, the true intended meaning of the law. And I'm assuming that's what occurred here, that he was trying to interpret the true intended meaning of the law.
What so, day? What data he interpreted.
For us to make this bring it to a final point is based on this directive that we have received, we do believe it is under the auspices of the commission to at least entertain these appeals. Now, whether they're approved or not remains to be seen. So, unless there's any other comments, we will now move to the next phase, which is to have.
What date did he send it?
And again, remembering that we will not vote today for the
recommendation. And I don't want to prolong this, but can you please clarify again for me, are we entertaining the appeal or are we considering the application? I think those are two distinct things.
Based on my understanding of the directive that was sent by the state superintendent, we are looking at the
appeal. So we're not considering the application.
Well, the application is included in that.
So in the appeal process, we don't consider the original application and our response to that application. If we're considering the new application.
Well, you're talking about the amended?
The amended application, which is what NASA referred to. That's what they addressed with the amended application. If we're looking at the appeal according to the letter of the law. We're only looking at why we said no and whether or not our no's were valid. If we're looking at the new application, then that's a totally different things, and I just wanna be clear. Are we looking at the new application, what NASA is saying now? Are we looking at our field and why we said no, and whether or not our no's are valid?
You've raised a very valid point, in my opinion, and we're gonna have to get legal advice on that.
Well, why wouldn't you wanna look at the original?
I do like practice law, but I don't have a license, so we'll, but that's a valid point.
Right, right.
Others that you consult with would be prepared to try to frame that in a tighter way so that you could advise us prior to our meeting on May the 2nd as to what we are legally authorized to consider. Okay?
Do we know, Logan, you might be able to, did NASA consider the addendum to the application?
They told me. They said that they were not, but they did conduct a capacity interview. And so it's my thought that if there's new information, But they said they had stated that they were not going to consider new information, but they did conduct a capacity interview. So the information that came forward with that, I was not privy to that interview, so I'm not certain.
I think the document was, and I appreciate the fact that they did. As you read through this, you will see indications over and over again where they corrected again the items that we identified. So the two documents together, we identified again, we're not gonna run through them again, but we identified errors of truck funding. And they said in our meetings, they addressed it. We identified, and they mentioned even in their presentation last night that they hired a new CFO, who happened to be a former CFO for Birmingham City, to help them with the budget. And I had an opportunity to speak with them. They said, yeah, we went back and we redid the budget. After you all denied, and just mentioned endeavor and that's a report. Over and over again, you see where they've done some things to shore up the application based on their findings. So they meet, according to NASA, they meet the obligations, or they meet the requirements, but it's because they've done things to shore up. So NASA did not say, and it would help if they had said, definitively, well, we looked at the no's for Birmingham City, and we found them to be valid and invalid. But I think it's just as powerful when they say, over and over again, when you compare the R knows to why they say yes,
because it's not good.
It's clear. We said in one statement in our application, I mean in our findings, that they would best be served if they had an educational service provider. They reached out according to NASA and found someone to help them with the curriculum. You know, over and over again, they correct them, which is what we would expect. If we say no, and we list things, we expect any applicant to go out and make a correction, but we submit to us, you know, and that's, I think that's the appropriate step now that comes back to us. And this body, again, according to the law, we're looking at the appeal, where our no's valid.
And again, as we pointed out earlier, this is our first time.
Yes, sir.
So we're all trying to wait for the appropriate question. Are there any other comments or questions for Mr. Pettit? Thank you for that informed report. And we'll go to the next item on the agenda. Our first applicant that has appealed to the commission is Rising Star, and you will come forward and identify the people that are in your party that are officially part of the charter school, and then make your presentation. If you notice, we have allocated 45 minutes to include questions from the commission.
Are we still in morning? Good morning. My name is Ruben Morris. I am a representative of the applicant group and one of the co-authors of the actual application. My current position, I'm the executive director of the New Rising Star Community Support Corporation. Our 501c3 serves as the incubator for Star Academy. With us today, and the primary presenter will be Dante Moore. She's the executive director and founding principal of Star Academy, and Dr. Beavers, who's the pastor of New Rising Star, who's our primary community support partners. Before Dante goes into her actual presentation, I wanted to first take an opportunity to address actually some of the items that were presented by Mr. Tato in his report, and specifically the language component. I'm not going to take up too much time. First off, I first want to thank Mr. Tatum and Birmingham City Schools. I think that they put in a lot of effort in terms of preparing RFP. This is new for the state of Alabama. Everyone in here has really probably lost some sleep trying to figure out what this process is going to look like. And for us, this has been a journey that has started really almost a year and a half ago. So first and foremost, as it relates to the actual RFP, we were surprised at the narrow nature of this particular RFP. Dante and myself both have extensive experience in the charter world. Both Dante have experience in New York, and myself, not only as a charter school teacher, but also as someone who's gone through a charter incubator leadership program, and someone who has worked on the district level to help kind of create a path for where charter schools should go in the state of Georgia and many other places. And because of those experiences, we've all seen RFP processes, we've seen calls for quality schools, but we have seen school districts that have indicated based on demographic trends, whether they needed a middle school, whether they were looking for a high school, et cetera, but never one specific type of model for a school. With that said, as a team, we went to the data, we went and did research based on the area that we decided we wanted to serve within East Birmingham, and looked at what are the needs, and did a needs assessment on what are the current schools, how are those schools performing academically, what are the needs, whether it be literacy, math, et cetera, and we decided on the STEAM model with a focus on project-based learning, personalized learning, et cetera, based on our experience in terms of what has been proven as models that have shown success across the country with this specific demographic, and what the community is actually asking for. And I think that's something that has to be considered with us having a very close tie to folks in the community and having conversations with parents and families, what type of school they actually wanted and considering when we actually built out this application. From my own personal experience as a former principal of an international school in Denver where the population is majority English language learners, there's been a lot of research and debate around whether or not a dual language immersion model is the best model in terms of really impacting student achievement, and the jury's still out. There's a, if you look at large school districts, urban school districts that have done that, you can point to Portland where they've had maybe some mixed reviews in terms of the impact of a dual language model there. In Denver, I know specifically, having worked in that system for several years, there was only one or two schools and at the end was mixed reviews. My own school where I was a principal, we actually had a newcomer center and early immersion models and a lot of things as it relates to English language learners and dual immersion. And really, what we found is that it's not necessarily the best model, even for students where English is not their first language, much less for students where English is their first language. And we took that experience and research and data into determining what exactly the model that we were going to use. And it's not a matter of us not wanting to work with Birmingham City Schools, it's not a matter of us actually not listening to them, because we've documented on several occasions that we actually did reach out to Birmingham City Schools. I did send a letter to this body, this commission, that outlined all of our communication, even though the majority of it was with Dr. Kaku. So several times we had to meet, have conversations, and to discuss our intent to actually apply for a charter school. We also recognize that we, as being one of the first African groups, were given two different timelines. There was a state timeline and there was a Birmingham City timeline. For whatever reason, those timelines as of 2016 did not align. And so we did apply directly to the state following guidance from representatives from NACS and other state officials as it relates to charter schools, but it was all in good faith. Once we did receive Birmingham's dates and timeline for actually applying, we followed those. And we also went through that process and had a capacity interview. During that capacity interview that we actually have documentation of, including recording, a lot of the nine things that were pointed out were actually addressed in that moment, and we can speak to them specifically. actual ruling was made. Simple things like we had a CFO from the beginning of our process. We had an education service provider, New Tech, that we engaged while we were writing our application. Some of these things that have been pointed out here today as being something that we just did recently are actually just not true. These are things that have been in place for the entire time. And the whole point of what we're trying to do is not to go above and beyond what Birmingham City Schools is doing. The best practice for charter schools, from my experience and what research says, is for charter schools to work in concert with school districts. Denver Public Schools serves as an example of one school district where, obviously, much larger than Birmingham City Schools, but it is an urban school district that was hemorrhaging enrollment. Enrollment is going to continue to hemorrhage in Birmingham City Schools, whether we open a school or not, because kids want choices and want high quality options. If Birmingham City Schools could think about a potential portfolio option to where they look at innovative practices at charter schools and other different types of schools and work together with those charter and other types of school choice options, I think it's a win-win for students. Because at the end of the day, that's why we're here. We're not here for political reasons. We're not here, you know, to get rich or any other narrative that's floating around right now. The whole goal and what we've operated from the beginning is to work with Birmingham City Schools to be a partner for the kids in East Birmingham and Birmingham in general. And I really want the record to show that that's our motivation and our intention. I want to turn this over to John Taylor.
As he mentioned, my name is Jonte Morris. I serve as the founding principal and executive director of Star Academy. We are a proposed pre-kindergarten through eighth grade school in Birmingham, Alabama. And so just our time this morning will be, and I'll use my teacher voice so that I can move around. We'll talk about our why and hear from a few community members, context that matters, our mission, our growth plan, instructional vision, cultural vision, year one priorities, a day in the life, and time for Q&A. At Star Academy, we believe education equals freedom, opportunity, and hope. All children possess an inherent capacity to excel and learn. Our students are shining stars who are passionate and innovative leaders. We create meaningful and collaborative, student-driven learning experiences that holistically empower our stars to discover their limitless potential by redefining what is possible. We are self-aware and confident individuals who lovingly hold ourselves and others to high expectations and will use our collective voice to create transformative change for our community and world. And so with that, I think we should hear from voices that truly matter, and that's community voices. And I'll have Dr. Thomas Beavers come up for a couple moments and just speak to about his vision for the East Lake community.
Hey everybody, thank you so much. Honored to be here today. And why Star Academy? And why would a pastor of a church have a vision for a public charter school, knowing that it is a public charter school and that it's not a private charter school? Our church is located in zip code 35206. That zip code is high crime and high poverty. I believe that the two are interconnected. When people don't have what they need, they take it by any means necessary. I also believe that wherever you see high poverty, there's also a disparity in the educational system. At our church, we've always had a vision not just to get people saved and go to heaven, but we want them to have access to a high quality of life on earth. We believe that one of the primary ways to do that is specifically through education. So we already have many educational services that we facilitate at our church, starting with the Early Childhood Learning Center from 6 weeks old to four years old. After that, when school is out, we are in. We have a summer enrichment camp that houses just north of 200 kids. We have a spring enrichment camp of 75 kids and an after-school enrichment program where we pick up from 12 different schools, many of them which are Birmingham City Schools. We bus them back to our church, our campus. Feed them a healthy snack, we share the gospel, and we help them with tutoring as well. And so basically, when school is not working in, our philosophy behind that is to prevent learning loss. And not just prevent learning loss, but to help kids so that when they go back into the classroom, they will be ahead of the curve. A quite natural next step for us is STAR Academy, K-4 through 8 charter school. And one of the reasons that we wanted to do it is just to help further our mission to turn a dilapidated community into a developed community. Not only am I the pastor of New Rising Star Church, many people don't know, I am a parent of kids who are currently in the Birmingham City School System. I do have 7 children. I know that I don't look old enough to have 7 children, but I do have 7 children. And all of my kids, with the exception of my youngest child, who is not of age, are in the Birmingham City School System right now. I can speak not just as a visionary for STAR Academy and a visionary for our community, but I'm also speaking as a parent. I want for children what most of my children were not able to have. And that's because when STAR Academy starts, my children will be past the age limit to go to STAR Academy, with the exception of my youngest child. So I don't just want it for my children, I want it for everybody's children. I believe that STAR Academy is a wonderful choice and a wonderful option. Once again, we try to work in concert with Birmingham City. We do have documentation on record via email trails where we have reached out to them. As soon as we knew that we would apply as early as February or March of 2016, only to get vague responses. Not only that, but as mentioned before by our executive director, the capacity interview, from our understanding, was to address any questions that they may have about our application. And at that time, we addressed several of these questions, and we did actually record that interview. If any of you would like a copy of it, I'd be more than happy to send it to you. Thank you so much.
I'd now like us to just really zoom in to the parents and families and children. So the next question we'll hear is from prospective parent and her daughter, London.
Ms. Alexander, if you could first introduce yourself and your daughter and tell me why you were fighting for STAR Academy to open.
Well, I am
Brandon
Taylor. I am here with my four-year-old, and my reason why
going into my next question, which I think is great. Why do you think Birmingham or Eastlake, or how do you think Birmingham or Eastlake would benefit from another option, another choice for parents and families?
Well, I just know, I don't think I know that it would just help a lot of mothers who's out here who does not have the funds to put their kids in private schools. It would definitely just be a great thing for us, and it will give us a second chance instead of putting our kids into city schools or putting them into private schools and paying those tuitions that we can't afford.
Mm-hmm.
We can't afford that.
How do you think STAR will help the community?
It will be all, I think it will help the community. I think that they'll have a lot of different great